Hey guys, it's Jordan here, back with a new video. Sorry I haven't uploaded in a long time. We've been working on a lot of stuff reenactment-wise for our group S, that's Gruppe Junge. So I haven't been giving the YouTube channel and its productions much attention lately. That and a couple academic stuff is coming up, like the TSI. So if you're going to college and you're in the state of Texas, look out for that. But we're back with another video. Today I'm just going to be talking about my German tunic. More so as to what to do with the German tunic when you get one. So, let's get into it. First thing I want to talk about is the weathering process. I'm going to leave the video link in the description and probably some kind of mention or picture of the video up on screen at this point in time. If you guys don't know how to weather your tunic, I'll just give it a quick run through in a bit. But I highly recommend you check out this video. I'm pretty sure Panzersoldat and World War Guy also made similar videos about how to weather your tunic. I know Paralight Works, the all-time greatest inspiration for German World War II short films on YouTube, also made a video about how to weather their German tunics. It's a pretty simple process, but I'm going to be doing, I forgot his name, but the video I'm showing on screen right now. But, you know, just know that other people have also made videos and you can check them out as well. And they're all really good processes. It's just, you know, which one you prefer and what the look you're going for is. So, I believe how he taught me how to do this was to, well, first off, wash it, hand wash it. Never put your German tunic, or any German tunic, any tunic for that matter, that's made out of wool or anything, you know, before the 60s, into a laundering machine or, you know, dry clean. Just always hand wash. Put in a bucket, you know, put soap on it, dry it, you know, stuff like that. It's pretty simple. Hand washing has been around for a long time. So, hand wash it, give it a couple mud baths, and then burn the, here, I'll hold it closer to the camera, burn the fabric of the wool with a lighter or some kind of, you know, flamethrower, I don't know, just don't burn the entire tunic, just burn, like, the top fabric of the wool, because when you first get a wool tunic, you got all this kind of, I guess you can see some of it right here. If you guys can see this white stuff right here, that's going to be the stuff that you want to burn off. It's pretty much just excess dust, lint, anything that you would normally get on a wool tunic, because it's wool, and that kind of stuff adheres to that fabric. So you just burn it off. Like I said, I'm just skimming through it. If you guys want a proper video, I can make one of my own, or you guys can just check out the link of the video that I mentioned earlier in the description. But, you know, first off, you weather your tunic. That's basically step one, especially before you start putting random things on it. Or not random things, before you start putting anything on it. Next, you're going to want to replace the buttons. I didn't actually replace my buttons. This tunic is from Epic Militaria. A lot of you have been asking. Well, now you guys know. It's from Epic Militaria. It's not the greatest reproduction, but it's definitely cheap and affordable. And it was one of the first vendors that I started off buying things from and still buy things from just for the sake of making films. For reenactment, you know, there's definitely better places you guys can go to. But Epic Militaria, definitely a place I recommend just from experience. But, you know, I didn't get these replaced, but you can tell they're already wearing down already from use. I've had this tunic for about a year or two. But, you know, replacing your buttons really do add up to the impression. These are repro, Epic Militaria repros. If you guys replace them with the original, it's pretty easy. You flip them around to the back. You can see here, this is where the buttons are tied down, you know. Cut that knot, take it out, put another one in, tie the knot around, and then seal it at this area. The port where it's not focusing. Right here. That's what I'm talking about. The port where the button's tied. So, replace it with original buttons. Great idea. That goes for every single button on the tunic. So that would be, I don't know if your tunic has, you know, five. Mine has five because it's a Waffen SS M43 tunic, but it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Tunic buttons, and it's got 1, 2, 3, 4 pocket buttons. Your here or SS tunic might have 5 or 6, you know, according to various sources, especially in the Bundesarchiv and forums, you know, talking about 5 or 6 button tunics. It's a very controversial topic. As far as I know, both are okay, especially if you're doing late war, early war. Here's supposed to have 6, SS is supposed to have 5. mid-war is where this transition started happening, where Waffen-SS started using here, and here used Waffen-SS, and the whole German supply depot situation got really, really messy, and production started, you know, cutting down on these stuff. So, as far as I know, 5 or 6 tunic buttons, and 4 more generally, just for pocket buttons. And if your tunic has, I know M43 is not really supposed to, but this repo does. I don't know, you know, what to talk about that, because I haven't done too much research about internal pockets on German tunics. But if you have an inside, you know, a hidden pocket, internal pocket inside your tunic, and it comes with these buttons, you can replace these as well. Epic's internal buttons comes, you know, like right here, comes in black buttons, but I know there were brown buttons on original tunics. There was a brown-black blend buttons on original German tunics, and there are definitely silver buttons that even I have seen on original tunics. And one thing that you guys don't know, thanks, cheers to our military expert, Aiden, for bringing this up. Remove your collar buttons inside M42 or M43 tunics. I have an M43. I'm not really concerned about the historical accuracy. Oh, that's a gecko. Hello. Interesting. I'm pretty sure it's pregnant. Okay, cool. But alright, back on topic. Remove your collar buttons for M42/M43. You really don't need these. Just take them, cut the knot inside, take them out. Yeah, I don't know as to why. I'm pretty sure it's just because they weren't even included in late war or mid war productions or whatever. But get rid of them. Y'all don't need them. That goes for some buttons in the sleeves as well. I have these rolled up from last time. Alright, I have no idea where to find them, but there are buttons on the sleeves as well, both sleeves. Or at least for the Epic Military Repro. So, there we go. Keep in mind that this tunic also looks kind of wonky internally. Like how. I'll move the tunic up a little bit so I can see, but how, you know, this is straight up right next to these two holes here for the belt loops. Yeah, it's because this is custom tailored. My body size is really, really small. Or not really, really small. Just smaller than average, the average American, or, well, in this case, British person, since this came from Britain. And they were using the British male sizes. So, had to get this retailored to my body size. But, yeah, yours should still look somewhat similar, so what I'm going to talk about next should be okay. I'm going to talk about what these are for next, and what these two front buttons right here are for. These are for belt loops. So if your belt is too heavy and it looks weird or uneven on your tunic, and you want something to help hold that weight other than Y straps, because trust me, Y straps cannot hold all the weight. I'm going to answer another question real quick. A lot of concerns that you guys have is regarding on my "What does an infantryman have" in 1944 video. My Y straps are too slung over. One was because I'm wearing half Car 98 pouches, half P38 holster, so I unbalanced them on purpose so they can hook onto the belt, which is something I already fixed, in the future past that video. And two was why the Y straps were slung over so weird on my shoulder. They're supposed to stay on the back, on the opposite side of the shoulder near my shoulder blades, so I can wear the assault pec or stunge pec. I know that now, and I have fixed it. It's still a bit loose on me, so I can wear correctly on the back side of my back, which is why my belt is still uneven and my Y straps are still a little bit too loose, because of my small torso. That being said, belt loops are the way to go. Now, these are also from Epic Militaria. I know a couple guys who recommended me better sources years ago. I don't know what those sources are now, but if you ask around, you will definitely find your answers. Belt loops, how you do them inside. Every single belt loop, 2 in the back, 2 in the front, on both sides, they have this, you kind of just choose your hole. I chose the middle hole. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 on my pull-down tab. So what I do is, there's a tutorial, but here, I'll take this out and do it again on screen. So, this is what the loop looks like. You have the loop, and you have this. I chose the 4th hole down, which is the hole in the middle, because there's 7 holes in total, and this is the median. Well, it's kind of hard to do this on camera. I hope I get this on screen. But you slide the video randomly stopped recording. Apologize. But you take this, the belt hook, this way. and you slide it into the hole that you want it to be. I slide it through the middle just because I don't really care where it goes in, and the middle is just kind of average for everyone. And then you do so until it goes in here, and then you slide it up here. And then you take the hole in the tunic where you're supposed to go to. As far as I know, the correct hole is always down on, the most... Some tunics have two or three, that's why I'm saying this. But usually the correct way is that it always goes on the bottom hole. If you want to readjust this just so it can fit you, that's fine. But I'm just going to do it on the bottom hole because I don't need it too far up on my waist, my belt, and stuff up my waist. And you pull it through and just a little bit out. You can pull it all the way out, just pull it a little bit, just that much, halfway up. And this, you just kind of pull it down and readjust it from the inside and outside until it matches the thing completely. And then the belt just kind of slides in here and rests on your waist. I'm going to turn the tunic around just so I can show you the ones in the back. Okay, so there's two here for every tunic. Flip that over. And there's two in the back for every tunic. So, that's that. Next, I'm going to be going on to insignia, because obviously that's a very big piece of your German tunic impression. So, once you've done that, I'm going to start with the... What is this? Oh, it's another belt loop. Alright, my bad. I thought I left something in the pockets before I got this thing washed, which would be very concerning. But, I'm going to start with the collars and the collar tabs. So, I promoted myself for the sake of Ersatzgruppe Junge, the reenactment aspect of the historian, and what you guys see playing the actors in films. Just fix that real quick. I'm the commanding officer of that group, Ersatzgruppe Junge, so I promoted myself to SS Oberschaftsführer. That being said, your collar tabs probably don't look like this, they probably look different, they probably have stripes, they're probably blank, and they probably, depends on what, they probably have oak leaves, it depends on what rank you are. I'm an SS Oberschaftsführer, which is an NCO rank. Junior NCO. So, ignore the pips. But, the collar tabs, pretty simple. I already have tress on mine, but there's supposed to be a vague outline. No, not even vague. A very defined outline running through here. You just put the collar tabs however you'd like, with the borders colliding on the outline as the best as you can. Since you can already see a little bit here, it's like the stripe. And it looks like this. This is on the down on the collar, further down on the collar, but it's supposed to look like this. Just a stitched stripe. Every single tunic has one. And that's where you align your collars to, just trying to make it the best you can. At the bottom touching the bottom stitch, the side in this case touches the side stitch. And then the top and that rests like that. So when the collar bends, it looks like this from the side and it looks like this from the top. Just do the best you can. It doesn't have to be perfect. There are collar tabs. So the SS one goes on the it's on the left looking from the front, right? But if you're wearing it, it's on your right, and this goes on your left. So SS is always on this side, however you want to look at it, and your rank is always on this side. That being said, two pips means Oberschaftsführer. I actually sewed these pips myself into this because this used to be a Schutze tab. You guys can buy this pre-order or pre-made or whatever. It depends on what rank you are and how much money you really want. I just kind of made a hole in my Schutze tab. I put these pips in. You can do the same. It doesn't matter. It's up to you. So that's that. I'm gonna cover tress next since it's the next best thing closest to the collar tabs. I was talking about the stitch line like this, where you align your collar tabs to. Tress, basically, you just kind of cut it here. This is where it begins. You can literally just cut the tab. It's just tress. It's just a giant line of silver tress. Tress is the term used for this, by the way, this design right here. It's just a long strip of fabric, aka tress. And you cut it somewhere, or you take the beginning, you fold it under, like so. You can see the right here where I folded it under. Fold it under, sew it, and then you just kind of wrap around the entire collar. Here, if you're an officer, late war, officers wore enlisted men tunics, so you don't have to have tress if you're doing late war. However, I decided to go traditional and had my tunic get tressed, and also go, it wraps around all the way over here at the same area and cuts off. I used the collar hook as a as a guide. Every tunic has a collar hook, so you can wear your collar closed in closed weather, or whatever, you know, kind of ceremonial, or whatever situation your commanding officer wants, or how you want to wear your tunic into. This is the most commonly worn during the winter with the collar closed, summer with the thing open, but officers and enlisted men just like to play around their tunic, so it's just up to you how you wear your tunic. But, I use that as a guide. And you can see that I stop the chest right before it gets to any of this. So when you wear your collar closed, you can see the chest together. And you don't need to go really, really deep in all the way down to here. You can if you want. I don't think that's accurate. And I definitely have never seen any of the original photos go all the way down here. They usually just stop here, or they even stretched out here. So that's how you sew on the chest. Next is shoulder boards. Our shoulder boards, plural. I'm gonna undo my shoulder boards for you real quick. I don't want to get the other one down out. But this is what your tunic probably looks like when you've just like when you first got them, unless they already came with pre-installed shoulder boards. You're gonna have this. I don't know how to say this. This tab, I guess, and a pre-sewn button into here. Which if you want to replace, because I probably forgot the shoulder board buttons. I guess they're okay. But if you want to replace the shoulder board buttons with original buttons, it's sewn in here. Right here, I think. That's where the knot is. But, yeah, it's sewn in there internally. But this is probably what it looks like when you just got a tunic. So, you take this. This is a shoulder board for Obershaw, huh? Yours can look like whatever design on the front. It should look like this generally in under slash in the back. And these probably, I bought this from soldierfortune.uk. If they're crappy repros, you know, thanks for letting me know, if you let me know. But, like I said, we're just using this for casual reenacting and filming so far. So if I decide to get really serious about reenacting, I'll probably use better pairs. So be lenient on me. But every shoulder board should have this tab. So this tab goes first. The ugly colors are always on the inside, just letting you know. The ugly colors, what I mean is, you know, you wouldn't want this to stick out. It's always obviously the cool black sticking out. At least for SS, I'm pretty sure here shoulder boards have theirs as like field gray or something. Or maybe they're also black, I don't know. And the inside, the field gray, is under. In this case, the piping would stick out. The piping being the, you know, your unit, your branch. Honestly, if you guys don't understand what I'm saying, I'm really sorry. You guys have to trust me on this one and do some research on your own. I'm just explaining it for the sake of it. This white thing is the piping. They could be different colors depending on what kind of branch you serve, or what unit you serve. So if you're Panzer or Tankman, this would be pink or red. I don't know. You know, like I said, it depends. That's a whole new thing you want to do research about. It's called Waffenfarbe. I do have a pip on this. I'm a Oberstufe. This goes, you know, just under. You just pierce it through the top with these two prongs right here down to the underside of the shoulder boards, and then you they can go separate ways just so you can hold the prong together in here. And yeah, so you take the underside of the shoulder board, you button it. It's a pretty simple process, and boom. Make sure that you slide your thing through this tab first so it can stay here. The reason why shoulder boards existed was to, you know, you could wear it, or like it, well, first off, it designated your insignia, rank, branch, etc., and what you're doing in the military, but also they can hold Y straps in between them. So by unbuttoning this, sliding the Y straps through when you're putting it on, and then tying it back up, which is what I do sometimes since my Y straps are too big, but that's why they exist. They can also be called epaulettes. By, like, you know, English people or traditional Americans, because I had to use both terms when I was first doing research on this subject, because, you know, people use both terms. I say shoulder board just because it's easier. But yeah, that, and lastly, we're going to cover ribbons. Now, a lot of people are like, hey, how do you apply ribbons? And honestly, at first, I didn't know how to apply ribbons, so I had to figure out myself. Oh, this isn't last. I forgot the arm eagle, but I'll cover it in a bit. Last is the arm eagle. I don't know why I keep repeating that. All right, but we're covering ribbons. So there's two ways you can do this. First off, you obviously need a 6-inch of whatever ribbon. Hold on, my camera's about to cut out. Weird. For some reason, my phone can only record up to 10 minutes of video before it self-destructs itself, and I have to film this in, like, separate parts. I guess that makes it easier for editing. I don't know. We'll see. But, ribbons. First off, you need to order a 6-inch of whatever ribbon. I have an Ostfront ribbon, and I have a Eisernes Kreuz, I guess, Zweite Klasse? Yeah, ribbon. Which is the Iron Cross Second Class and the Eastern Front ribbon. Alright, I'll just explain them real quick. This is a word for bravery. If you get this multiple times, you get multiple classes. There's second class, which is just a ribbon, a first class, which is the Iron Cross medal you see on the left breast pocket, and then it goes on like the Knight's Cross and stuff that you wear around your neck with your tunic. But this is a second cross, word for bravery in combat, and this is a Iron Eastern Front ribbon, which means that as a soldier, I have served on the Eastern Front since 1942. So, and probably suffered frostbite or some kind of disgusting casualty that got me this ribbon. That's why it's called the Meat Order ribbon, and it is not a great ribbon to have, but it is an infamous one at that, so I just added it to the impression, for various reasons. But, you would wrap the ribbon. I'm not taking any of these out, by the way, they're a pain, personally a pain to do, but you would take the 6-inch ribbon and you'd wrap a little bit. This one, I had to improvise because this isn't 6 inches, this is like 4 or 3. So I had to improvise, and this one's a little bit short, but taking the Ostfront ribbon, a proper 6 inches to reference, I would put the beginning part in here. It doesn't matter how much goes back where, just enough to where it doesn't flop too much, you know, this end doesn't flop, and enough to where it wraps around the outside, down into the collar line here, you know, see both ribbons go around it, into the inside, where these are held. There's two ways you can hold these ribbons into your tunic. You can pin them like me with these pins that you get in like your average sewing kit or whatever that you can buy at Walmart for literally like 10 cents probably. A sewing kit being probably a dollar or two. And or you could sew these into your tunic just by sewing. Sewing is too much work, and I want to use these ribbons on different tunics so I can like interchange them. So right now for acting, they're on my tunic. But I have multiple tunics, like an enlisted .44 tunic as well that I sometimes wear. So if I want to switch over my Iron Cross or my Ostfront ribbon to that tunic, I can just unpin these and pull them out and then put them back in on another tunic. That's the plus about using these with pins. But if you guys want to keep them on your tunic permanently, this one's sliding out because it's too short. Let me fix that really quick. But if you guys want to use these permanently on your rib tunic, or you just don't see the need of, like, you know, interchanging them out with something else, feel free to sew. So, yeah, that's basically how. I would just take one or, yeah, about this is about 2 inches, wrap it around the front here. Keep in mind that there's an order to what ribbons goes on first. Usually it's war merit, and then other achievements at the bottom. So if I had like, if I was a, I don't know, let's say I was making an impression about a Wolfenstein general or something, you know, and then I want to have like myself like 300,000 ribbons, I would put the most prestigious ribbons first, like the war merit ribbons, the ones that you get for wearing around in combat and like destroying your enemies and stuff. You put those on first, so that'd be Iron Cross, War Merit Cross, whatever, blah. And then you have your lesser meritorious ribbons, like, losing my, like, 2 toes on my right foot, to frostbite, and getting the, Eastern Front ribbon. So, you know, that kind of stuff goes under, and then it goes so on. But if you have 300,000 because you're a Wolfenstein general, it'd probably go all the way down to your thing, which I don't know how to explain, because World War II soldiers probably had 2-3 ribbons at most, if they're like freaking like a war hero. But in this case, I have 2, and it's pretty much 1 or 2 is very common, especially late war, mid war. So I wouldn't recommend you exceed that amount. But if you want to, you know, do a impression about a Wolfenstein general, go ahead. But yeah, so 1 or 2 inches through the second button, always on the second button, mind you. Goes for every single tunic, that includes Panzer wraps, Kriegsmarine, stuff like that. And around the outside, into the collar line, and then you just sew or pin the rest up here. This one's still a bit long. I think it said 6 inches, but I think this came 8 inches individually. So I had to like tie this back around and loop it into the pin so it just doesn't dangle around on the inside. Make sure it's also unspottable for the most part on the inside. Keep it concealed. Let me move the tunic back over. Keep it concealed. This is the inside part of the tunic, so pretending that it's buttoned, you know, you wouldn't really normally see the pins or the inside of the ribbons. You just see the ribbons. But if you decide to wear it like this and it's showing a little bit, that's fine. That's normal. Some Germans wear their collars. I like to, especially in this Texas summer heat, like this, with the collar out, which is fine. But you can see this, and that's still fine. I'm just saying, you know, for the most part, if you wear it traditionally, like if you're at a ceremony and you have to wear your collar closed, etc., like so, that the inside of your ribbons are not sticking out, you know, naturally. They should just be going down to the car line and they stop right there. Because if they're sticking out, you'd probably get screamed at by your commanding officer, and that would not be nice. So, that's that. Lastly, I'm going to cover the arm eagle before my phone self-destructs again, because it takes videos in 10-minute intervals. The arm eagle. Pretty simple. There's no actual measurement for the arm eagle down from the sleeve. Actually, I think there is 5 or 6 inches. Though, honestly, as long as it's in the middle of the of your arm, it really doesn't matter. As I was told by a lot of people over the years. Again, if you want to reconfirm someone you know, go for it. But that's what they told me, and that's what I did, and it's worked out so far. So, they're the ones with the reference books, not me. But, so yeah, just center it from the arm, 5 or 6 inches down, or at least for the most part, just in the middle of your sleeve. I would prefer, no, not middle of the sleeve, sorry, middle of your biceps. This should not exceed any part from your bicep down to, if it's down here towards your elbow, you're doing it wrong. It should be right here, halfway up your bicep, or somewhere on your bicep. But yeah, 5 or 6 inches down is what I was told was a good recommendation. Centered in the middle of the left sleeve. If you're Waffen SS, you're always doing this on the left sleeve. Never do it on the right sleeve. Please, I've seen good guys with really wrong eagles, and it looks really funny. Don't do it. So that. And if you're a, you know, if you're a Gefreite or a Stürmer, and you have a chevron, or if you're like a volunteer group and you have your shield down here, just make sure it's just a quarter of an inch down from the middle of the eagle and use the eagle as reference. That's why it's so important for almost every single sleeve thing. I don't have a cuff title, but I'm just going to cover it really quick. I'm going to unfold the sleeve so I can show you guys. As far as I know, there are official websites. I don't need cuff titles. Personally, I'm not interested in cuff titles, so I don't know the measurements completely, but I believe it's a couple inches from the this line right here from the sleeve up to the seam and then around the entire sleeve. Again, I'm not sure. There are definitely websites like the Eshtazuga and stuff for it, but I don't know it. Because I, like I said, I don't really need to, and I'm sorry, but I should probably do more research on that myself. If you're here, and you have the breast eagle, I don't, so you guys are whack, okay? This is one of the reasons why I chose not to do here, because their measurement stuff was whack. Breast eagle for Afrika Korps goes all the way down here. This is only for Afrika Korps, so I'm saying like the arc of the eagles all the way down into the seam of the right breast pocket, okay? And I don't know why that is, but that's only Afrika Korps. And I said, only Afrika Korps. The usual here, eagle is usually above the pocket, I say a quarter of an inch. Sometimes it touches the seam, but never over the seam unless you're Afrika Korps. So, if you're not fighting Africa, don't even think about it, keep it up here. You can see this mistake in like Stalingrad 1993, the movie, where every single German, even though they weren't Afrika Korps, had the eagle down here. That is a mistake. Always keep it up here, a quarter of an inch above the left breast pocket. Maybe it could go up to half an inch. I'm not sure. Like I said, the measurements are wonky. Please do some research on that if you're doing here. But like I said, I did SS, so I don't really need to know that. I just kind of did my own work on the sleeve eagle because that's the only eagle the SS has to wear. So, that's about it. I don't think I left out anything else. If I did, let me know in the comments down below so I can make a follow-up video. But that should be the basics of what you guys need to know about a German tunic, and the measurements for tying up the insignia and everything. It's really hot outside. I really want to go inside, where the AC is broken, but still, it's probably better than standing out here. And, yeah, other than that, give your tunic mud baths and, you know, keep wearing it down. I've got blood stains on mine because we're using fake blood and stuff for some of our latest projects. Look forward to that. And, yeah, that's it. Hope you guys, you know, make the best out of this information. And I wish you the best of luck with your German impression. And, well, peace.
This fishy, this fishy ко мне, если я вдали, если трудно мне.